Now, in the category of food diversity, we have our second presenter, Mr. Satish Awate from Center for Environment Education, Pune, India. And his title is What's All in My Plate? So, Mr. Satish, you can share your screen.
Yeah, so good afternoon, everyone. I'm happy to present these learnings from our efforts to design a simple activity to engage with the students on various topics, starting with this was one of the activity designed under a broader educational program under Maharashtra Gene Bank project, where some 200 schools participated in the entire process, where we designed biocultural diversity and sustainability learning curriculum contextualized to Maharashtra. And so the curriculum was designed in four broad themes of agrobiodiversity, grassland and freshwater ecosystem biodiversity, and forest eco restoration. So within all these themes, learning areas were articulated through a consultative process with teachers, educators, partner organizations, community representatives, also through a design workshop involving textbook developers, pedagogists, and biodiversity and community experts. Basically, within the broad themes, the cutting across areas like exploring history, ecology, economics, gender, climate change, and policy programs. And within the learning areas, learning outcomes were articulated and corresponding learning activities were designed with their age appropriateness. With that curriculum, we studies in terms of creating baseline in terms of school students' current levels of learning when it came to various biodiversity events around them, and also the way school projects are being implemented today in the schools, which were introduced at least formally after NCF 2005. Adopted constructivist methodology of learning, and project-based learning was one of the mandated evaluation method recommended. And what we found, still even after 15 years down the line, school projects are done in non-constructivist method using rote and copy-pasting approaches. Everything seems to be driven by products and project materials available in the markets. So we went on developing what we refer as habitat-linked project-based learning. And over 60 different project ideas were designed and tested with these participating schools. And the most popular in terms of acceptance and reporting back by these school groups was What's All in My Plate. So everything was thought and designed using Marathi as a language medium. So what I'm presenting is a translation of it. So the map basically shows the distribution of the schools, I think around 18 districts spread across all regions, including administrative as well as agroclimatic zones of Maharashtra. For designing this particular activity, our objective was to design a simple and effective learning tool, helping learners reflect upon their own food diversity and develop appreciation for intergenerational changes that are happening when it comes to food and diversity, and also helping them relate and develop understanding about the changes happening in agriculture, in wilderness. Also appreciate diversity beyond the stereotypes of cuisine typically propagated by media. I mean, there are so many cuisine shows going on television, print media, and other social media as well. So, stereotypes propagated, say for example, when it comes to Maharashtra, Puran Puri, something from Pune in terms of non-veg, something from Kolhapur region as Tamda Pandra Rasa can be found everywhere. But then this is such a large state in terms of geography, little bigger than Italy. And in terms of population, almost I think more than Mexican population. In terms of linguistic and cultural diversity, is lost when these various media propagate these stereotypes. And also we're learning activities towards understanding concepts like climate change, food, water, energy nexus, and also something like global citizenship, which we often talk when it comes to sustainability. Followed by a mix of self-exercise when it came to mapping one's own food diversity, and also interview method while engaging with multiple generations within the same family. And they actually documented the food items from routine daily diet as well as food from special occasions. And a simple paper plate was used as a material. So from the first phase, we could have insights into the diversity of food among school children across the state, almost 10 districts of Maharashtra and different agroclimatic zones. So over 80% students did report consumption of bhakri, which is a traditional millet. But then again, 89% students also reported wheat and chapati. So perhaps what's happening here is the quantum of chapati is increasing and the quantum of traditional millet breads is decreasing, but it is still continuing to the large extent. Interestingly, students reported 21 different types of bhakris, not only made from millet, but also some multigrains, and also using rice, maize, chickpea, horse gram, and various traditional bhakris by way of mixing with the vegetables and fruits. So there are regional variations. Quite expectedly, students from scheduled tribal areas reported continuation of their traditional food and dietary habits relative to more agrarian and urban, near urban areas. Most of these participating students came from rural, in fact, from the remote scheduled tribal areas. And there were regional variations in their diets. When it came to rice, of course, obviously Western Ghat and the Konkan region was where 100% students reported rice in their diet, and some 99 names were reported by them, out of which 34 were traditional rice varieties. And it's quite significant in terms of, for a state like Maharashtra, a few decades back, which was having, say, around 500 rice varieties. And this is the scale at which traditional rice variety erosion has happened. And when it came to the various recipes to prepare bhat, 30 13 different recipes were reported, not only using rice, but also using millets. Another aspect was quite significant from biocultural diversity point of view was getting more than 100 names for wild vegetables and tubers, which are still consumed by these students from all parts. Obviously, there are variations between the region, and it itself emerged as a further research topic to develop database on regional variations when it comes to names of these wild vegetables and tubers, their nutritional analysis and possibilities towards domestication. And they reported all together some 12 different food items, like 46 types of chutneys, various pickles, and almost 20 different drinks accompanying meals, and papad varieties. When it came to non-vegetarian food, 39% student reported non-vegetarian food. So it is lower than the larger prevalence of non-vegetarian food in the state by way of our family surveys. It appears that the larger social cultural processes are pushing children, at least at the younger age, to shift from non-vegetarian food, which might be there in their larger family, but children are preferring or made to prefer vegetarian food, and this has an important implication when it comes to the nutritional security. This is a visualization we tried on prevalence and diversity of non-vegetarian food to communicate back to the school and students and teacher community. So one feature, if to highlight, I mean, student groups from Vidarbha region reported the largest diversity of both fish-based as well as non-fish, non-vegetarian food in their diet. And three-generational studies, which were conducted with 155 families who came from 33 different caste and community groups. They generated insights into the intergenerational changes and the hotspot areas when it came to the food categories such as wild food, which are those wild food resources still continue over three generations, and which are those foods like Caparis, Momordica, and Copulus, and Sesbania species. I mean, they are fast vanishing, especially from the third generation's diet. And similarly, learnings about tubers and traditional nutritious drinks like Ambil, which is overnight fermented millet-based drink, which is fast disappearing, along with Hulga Madga, which is horse gram soup. So only the Marathwada region and some pockets in Konkan reported continuation of these traditional drinks. So the key learnings of this design and testing with students as well as family groups, it's a great tool to engage with the learners in the area of biodiversity to start with, because we wanted to engage with them without getting them into the definitions of biodiversity or even using the word biodiversity. So food is very potential tool to start that engagement, to get people to talk about it, because it is so relatable, and people by way of their location and cultural backgrounds bring so much to the discussion, and also about history of the food, agriculture, domestication and migration of crops and cuisines. Effective learning about concepts of seasons, calendars, and also concepts like global citizenship can be dealt with this design. Developing understanding about malnutrition, linkages to diversity and changing habits. And it's also an important lesson that local foods need to be celebrated in context of climate change and silent crisis which is going on around us. And since food has become such a contested heritage as well as controversial present, with careful design, it can be creatively used to teach and learn about diversity, freedom of choices, and process of otherization. But it is important that the educators, competent teachers are needed to facilitate learning to overcome possible social biases and discrimination associated with the different food habits among the student groups. And in fact, carefully it can be used to teach about the caste system, food as a tool of discrimination. So thank you very much. I would love to take your questions and any comments.
Thank you, Mr. Satish, for showing this topic with so many different diverse perspectives. So Mr. Sanjay Jain has a question. He's saying that it was a very interesting poster. He has been interesting experience to share in this context. He has taken his students for a nature's walk, and their job was to discover vegetables, leaves which could be cooked. Amazingly, few of them could discover some of which were eatables, and we could cook and they cooked them and consumed. It was a fantastic experience. No one was hurt. Any your thoughts on this experience?
It's great. Of course, I mean, we while taking students on these wild trails and also this wild food cooking camps, I mean, it is quite important to take care of the safety of the students. But then again, I mean, what a fantastic topic such exercise offers us as educators to engage with the learners, to ask them that how we as a humanity or a particular community might have arrived at the range of food which we consume today. So in the process, many of the people must have dry tested and fall sick, and many must have died. So we really need to be grateful to our ancestors who actually explored the wilderness and carefully made the choices which we went on and developing to the food. And similarly, I think not only engaging them with the topics which are associated to the local realities, but as I mentioned, that we can also engage with them to deal with complex concepts like global citizenship. Say, for example, I mean, many of the students and teachers as well were surprised when we collectively found that Jowar and Bajra's millets didn't belong to India. They didn't originate in India. And in fact, they came to India from East Africa around 4,000 years back when the historical climate change was... we were facing historical climate change and the earlier agricultural system was no longer feasible, and that's how these climate hardy crops from Africa helped us to build our resilience. So it is the free exchange of material and people, which builds us resilience. And that's all at the heart of the entire discussion about global citizenship as well. So there are many ways you can build your learning process design.
Thank you. And Rakshita Gupta has a comment. She found the research very super intriguing.
Okay.
No more questions. So really interesting to see you pointing out the issues of constructivist learning, which we often see getting neglected in actual practical situation. But it was interesting to see you mention that part about including constructivist issues in the pedagogy.
Thank you. I just put my email address for further conversations. Thank you.